The upper chest. When you look at bodybuilding greats like Arnold posing, a well-developed clavicular head definitely completes the physique. I mean, let's just imagine what it'd look like if his upper chest was lagging. Not so great. So in this video, I want to lay out four specific strategies for growing the upper chest as quickly as possible. So off the bat, I think it's important that we prioritize the chest in general in a variety of different ways. So before we get into the four specific tips, I'm going to blast through these general prioritization principles. First, you want to hit your chest earlier in the workout when you're fresher and stronger. This is going to lead to better performance and more overload. Second, you should tally up how many sets of chest you're currently doing per week right now. It might not be enough, or it might be too much. According to this blog post from Dr. Mike Isratel, most intermediate to advanced level lifters respond optimally to 12 to 20 sets per week, but most people start running into recovery issues above 22 sets or more. Now, I would say to focus on the four steps laid out in this video first before turning to jacking your volume up. Once you've got the proper techniques handled, then you can start adding one or two sets per week over the next month or two as you assess your progress, working your way up through that 12 to 20 set optimal zone. Third, the easiest way to get your chest volume up quickly is by hitting it more frequently. So if you're currently only hitting your chest once per week on Monday, start hitting it twice per week, such as by doing push workouts on Monday and Thursday, like in my push-pull legs hypertrophy program, which I'll link below. All right, so let's dig into the four steps for rapid upper chest growth. The first step is to modify your bench press technique. Now, the reason I'm putting the bench press in the first spot here is because if you can build up a stronger bench press, it's going to have strength carryover to all the other exercises we're going to cover. And while a lot of people think that the flat bench is only going to hit the mid and lower pecs, looking at this study from Barnett and colleagues, you can see that even though decline and vertical presses were significantly worse at hitting the clavicular or upper head, the horizontal press at 0 degrees incline and incline press at 40 degrees were actually pretty similar. Now, with that said, I think there are two ways that you can get more upper chest out of your flat bench. The first modification is to use slightly lighter weights for higher reps. This doesn't mean you should totally skip your heavy bench pressing altogether, but periodic rep variation is smart. And in a 2015 write-up for Alan Aragon's research review, Dr. Brett Contreras found that his upper pec activation peaked at 225 pounds and then dropped off once he went heavier than that. This led him to suggest that doing the flat bench with approximately 10 to 15 rep loads while directing the focus to the upper pecs by using the mind-muscle connection could offer an advantage. Now, this isn't a particularly strong form of evidence. It's just one anecdotal case report, and EMG findings may not necessarily imply greater hypertrophy, but I think it certainly points towards something that could be worth experimenting with yourself. The second way we want to modify our bench press technique is by bringing our grip slightly in. Even though you won't be able to move as much weight this way, if you're more concerned with developing your upper chest in particular, a closer grip will likely hit the upper fibers better. In that same study from Barnett et al., they found higher upper pec activation at one times shoulder width than two times shoulder width. This is because the clavicular head of the pec contributes to shoulder flexion, and closer grips emphasize shoulder flexion. You can try this out for yourself. Just raise your arm up like you would in a front raise, and you should feel your upper pecs contracting. Okay, the next step is to add more incline presses. I think a good overall setup running with the push-pull leg split would be to hit the modified bench press on the first push day and an incline dumbbell press on the second push day. The reason I'm favoring dumbbells over barbells here is that you're going to be able to get a bit more range of motion with the extra stretch at the bottom, so the shortcomings of the barbell press are overcome by using dumbbells on the second push day. Now, you'll remember from earlier that flat and incline presses elicited similar activation in that Barnett paper. However, a later 2010 paper with a larger sample size actually did find a significant difference. Even though it doesn't look like much on the graph, a 44 degree incline elicited significantly more EMG activity than both 0 and 28 degree inclines, implying that slightly higher inclines between 44 to 56 degrees might be best for most people. Now, a caveat of this study is that all presses were done on the Smith machine, and that made me wonder if the Smith machine would actually affect pec activation differently than free weights. So I dug up this study from Schick et al., comparing the Smith machine bench and the free weight bench. And even though they found a big difference in side delt activation, there was actually no difference in pec activation. So this leads me to think that the results from that Trebs paper probably can be extrapolated to free weight presses. And a cue I like to use on the incline press to drive upper chest focus is to keep the elbows moderately tucked and think about pressing the dumbbells up and back toward your face rather than just straight up. Okay, step three is to incorporate more non-traditional exercises such as the reverse grip bench press, band press, and banded push-ups. Now, first of all, I think including a variety of different exercises in any program seems to help with growth across all heads of any given muscle group. In 2014, Fonseca and colleagues split 70 subjects into groups doing only squats and groups doing squats, leg press, deadlifts, and lunges. They matched training volume across all subjects. And after 12 weeks, even though total quad growth was the same, only the group varying their exercises saw significant growth across all heads of the quads, meaning the group doing only squats didn't see significant gains in the rectus femoris and vastus medialis heads. Now, obviously, this is a lower body study, but I think the general principle here that varying exercise selection matters for maximizing muscle growth across an entire muscle group can extend more broadly. So the first exercise I'd experiment with is the reverse grip bench press. This was popularized recently by Greg Knuckles, who's got a beastly reverse grip press himself. Here you can see him doing 405 for 8 reps, and he's written about this variation as well, highlighting its potential value in hitting the clavicular fibers and for those who have shoulder or elbow issues when benching. And even though research has shown it to increase upper pec activation by 25 to 30%, this study used absolute loading, meaning it's possible that it might have only led to greater upper pec activation because the subjects were less experienced with it, making it more challenging. Still, I think this data makes it at least worth playing around with. You just want to make sure you've got a spotter handy and start out light when trying it for the first time. Banded push-ups and JC band presses were highlighted in Dr. Contreras' case study as hammering his upper pecs. So if you haven't ever experimented with these, I think they're worth giving a shot. Now, I'm personally a bit more wary of the guillotine press. It just feels a bit too risky to me. So I'd stick with the banded push-up and the banded incline press for higher reps in the 15 to 20 rep range to see if you feel them working your upper chest as well. And finally, the fourth step is to fill in any extra weekly volume required for progress with isolation work. For this, I personally prefer low to high cable flies. I've discussed in other videos that while dumbbell flies can be effective for really stretching out the pecs at the bottom, they completely lose tension at the top, whereas cables have a much more consistent tension curve. Also, when pulling the cables from low to high, you can mimic the exact orientation of the clavicular fibers, which also run from low to high. You might feel this in your front delts, and that's okay, but if you really focus on the mind-muscle connection and actively squeezing your upper pecs together, you should feel your upper pecs contracting the most. Now, you can also optionally cross your arms over at the top to really max out that upper pec contraction and range of motion. So putting all of this together, I'd say a killer upper chest focused plan might look something like this. And you can pause or screenshot the screen here if you'd like to look at it more closely. And if you're interested in putting all of this together into a complete routine, I'd recommend checking out my 8-week chest hypertrophy program, which includes most of the exercises in this video, private video tutorials for each movement from me, and an explanation of all the chest biomechanics and anatomy. And I'm gonna knock that program down to 25% off for the next week, so you can pick it up for just $14.99 in the description box below. And I'd also recommend checking out my 16-week push-pull legs program if you're looking for a complete full body routine using a split that's going to emphasize the push muscles twice per week. Also, make sure you guys check out my last video on 4 steps to blow up your bench press if you haven't already. Don't forget to leave the video a thumbs up if you found it helpful, subscribe if you haven't already, and I'll see you guys all here in the next video.